Rachel's here.
Well, there.
Hello, hello.
Hey, how are you?
Could we get soft? Sorry, but I'm tall.
Ms. Roy, how are you?
I'm good.
Hang in there. What a day. Boston Bruins coach got fired.
Really?
Yeah. I didn't hear that.
Aaron Hernandez was found guilty.
Oh, yeah.
My son... My son went to the Red Sox game and met a bunch of the Bruins players outside Fenway.
Oh, nice.
So they were all hanging out with the Red Sox while their coach was getting fired. That was like heaven for him, though. Red Sox and the Bruins.
Yeah,
he was like, yay!
Hopefully he had a pen.
Yeah. Yeah, I bet he got one real quick.
I was listening, they were interviewing the jurors, Hernandez, and also the bee guy, the bee murder in New York. He was guilty?
Yeah.
Really? Were they charged?
First degree murder.
First degree.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
No parole.
But only, and Hernandez.
Life in prison, no parole.
Yeah, Hernandez.
I think he was a little surprised.
The jurors actually said that what convinced them of his guilt was Kraft. Kraft's testimony.
Craddy.
No, he said that was critical.
Yeah, critical.
He lied to Kraft, right to his face, about the whole thing.
Okay.
They talked to him. Yeah.
They think
he really.
I think he was surprised.
It's mandatory. There's no consideration.
Why is the Sarnia or whatever the.
That's a federal case.
The difference. The death penalty is an option in that case.
Right.
But they'll have to send it, but they'll have to do it outside of the state of Massachusetts if they do it.
Right.
Okay.
But I think by the reaction that he had when they came down with the verdict, I think he was surprised. I don't think he expected to get.
Yeah, his hopes must
be
enough. The day is went by.
Yeah.
Is he up for murder? Is two other workers too?
Yeah.
One more. Narcissists are always surprised when they get caught. They don't believe they're guilty.
Wow.
I guess two points. Good evening. Welcome to the April 15th workshop meeting for the council. This evening's topic will be for the proposal for the pay-as-you-throw program that Scarborough was looking at. And so what we'll do this evening is we'll go ahead and have the town manager who's here, as well as Mike Carr, our public works director, kind of talk about the program, and then we'll ask questions after.
Right. Yeah, we have a full hour, so I hope we can certainly get through our short presentation, then have enough time to take all your questions as well. Perhaps it's best just to give a little context and background as to kind of how we arrived at this point. This is a matter that Mike and I have been talking about since I've been here. Perhaps he had the same conversation with my predecessor. But really, starting in 2007, the town for the first time took on significant expense related to solid waste management, and that was the institution of our curbside collection program. With that came an expense of about $1.3 million or so, and that's fully and solely supported by the tax base. That program, by all accounts, is a rousing success, and we'll get into some of the metrics that verify that, and has been an unqualified success from a financial point of view. It saved us significant money that we will share with you. And each of the years that I've been your manager, there has been an interest on the part of council to always look at non-property tax revenue sources. And this is one of the ones that always has come to the forefront of my mind in terms of it being a relatively new municipal service, being one that's kind of ready-made for user fee systems. And then Again, this year, we found ourselves in a challenging budget year. It seems like every year we say this will be the worst one yet. Next year, we'll say the same thing, I suspect. But things accelerated fairly quickly. Councilor Babine, on behalf of the Finance Committee, arranged a solid waste-related discussion with the Finance Committee in early March. And as part of that conversation, Mike and I kind of tagged this on kind of as a future forward-looking item that we might want to consider. And frankly, to our surprise, the Finance Committee members were very encouraging to us. And really, the timing was such that I, within 2 weeks of that meeting, had to propose a budget. And so I have included components of a delayed start pay-as-you-throw program in the next fiscal year. So that's a piece that the Finance Committee will need to drop back to, depending on kind of the full council. So I do apologize for the fact that three of you on the Finance Committee have heard this proposal, yet four of you haven't, and it's been out there for about 3 or 4 weeks. Many of you are, you know, being asked your opinions about something you've not been briefed on. So I apologize. This was really the first time we could get the full council's attention to this proposal. So that's kind of the backdrop and what brings us together. I'm going to have Mike kind of walk us through a quick presentation, and what you see tonight is really modeled after a report that Mike and I put together, or kind of an overview. I apologize for the lateness of this document. It was finalized just yesterday. It's been posted on the web. It's a fairly quick read and easy read, I hope. We're going to follow that same basic format tonight and at least get through that, and we're pleased to take questions as you go. So with that, I'd love to turn it over to Mike
we're not flickering tonight, at least.
Yeah.
So we got that going for us. Well, Tom mentioned that the pay-as-you-throw thought has been around for. I know that when we were talking about the automated system back in 2006, then town manager Ron Owens and I had at that point in time discussed the whole idea of. Had discussed at that time various options, going, which was stay as we work, which was the option of just traditional curbside, and then the automated system, which was very new at the time. Goffstown, New Hampshire was one of the first communities that was doing that. Saco took it on then after that, and they had a three-bin system because at that point in time there was still two-stream recycling and that sort of thing. But I'd like to back up just a little bit and kind of talk about the pay-as-you-throw system in general, kind of a higher overview of it. And as it says in the report, pay-as-you-throw is just that. It's a metered service. It's a unit-based service. Instead of just as we buy gasoline by the gallon and pay for electricity by the kilowatt hour and that sort of thing, this follows that model, basically. It's unit-priced. The unit is, in this instance, in this particular model, is a bag, probably either a 13-gallon bag or a 30-gallon bag or something like that. But pay-as-you-throw is not new. It's been around since the 70s. Interestingly enough, California and Michigan were two of the states that kind of got into this in the early 70s and started moving with it. So. Nothing new. I think a lot of us here in the room either have direct experience from living in other communities where there has been a pay-as-you-throw program, or we know folks that live in communities, be it Cumberland or Windham, I know, Gorham, for instance, as well, are communities that have a pay-as-you-throw system. And so pay-as-you-throw is something that takes in, it promotes a couple of things, promotes three things. The environment, you're putting less waste into the waste stream, MSW, and that happens in a number of ways. People become more diligent with their recycling, but also it starts further back than that, and it starts right at the store. You start thinking a little bit more. It occurs to me since I've been director here, I've been on the board of Eco Maine, And I've seen the economics of trash and the cost. And so, you know, I think we all typically we know about the cost of purchase and we have that cost of ownership. But it's really it's only been the last probably 10, 12, 15 years that we start thinking about the cost of disposal, that end of life. Because up until now, it was just so easy to take it to the dump or do anything like that. We really didn't factor that in when we were making our purchases and thinking about the overall picture. So, you know, that less waste idea starts right from the very beginning. And instead of saying, you know, if I need five, but the economy size has 10, and, you know, I know I'll probably have to throw in five out, but it's such a deal, I can't bear it, but to not buy that, you know, we all of a sudden change our minds at that stage, and it just continues on down through. So you have this environmental piece where you're buying less, you're creating less waste, you're starting to become a little bit more savvy with the products. Reuse, which is before recycling in the waste hierarchy, is starts coming to the forefront of our mind. And then, of course, recycling is additional recycling is another piece of that. And then the equity piece. You know, if I throw out, if I'm throwing out, you know, 300 pounds of waste myself on a year, and Councilor Blaze is throwing out 536 pounds of waste in the course of a year. You know, is the discussion of should I be paying as much? You know, I am paying my freight in terms of I'm paying to get rid of what it is that I have. So there's an equity issue there. And then again, the economics of it. The bottom line is that every ton of waste that we send to EcoMaine costs us $70.50. Doesn't matter. A ton of waste is $70.50. Every ton of waste we take out saves us $70.50. So it's a very simple equation as far as that goes. Again, just a quick discussion on where we are right now, where we were in the past. Up until 2007. Real traditional curbside collection system. There was trash only that was collected, and basically, if you could drag it to the curbside, it got picked up, got tossed in the back of the truck, got hauled off, and got disposed of. It was just that simple. It was really difficult to control any sort of you know, there was absolutely no metering. There was no way to try and get that waste stream to be reduced a little bit. It was the Wild West. And so, you know, in truth, from driving around, because I was here prior to 2007, I think that, you know, for the most part, everybody was reasonable, but there were some folks that pushed the envelope, to say the least. Spring of 2007 is when we started the automated. The automated system was based around a couple of things, and there were a couple of things that happened around that time that allowed us to go to the automated system. One of the big things that happened was EcoMaine went to single sort recycling, so it all went in one bin and then got sorted out from there. What that allowed us to do, part of getting this automated system going, was that we had to buy special carts for the trucks to grab onto and dump. We, instead of buying three carts for each housing unit, we only had to buy two. Even buying those two carts, that initial purchase was a lease purchase of about $750,000. That lease purchase will be up in November of 2016. So that was the big piece there, as far as being able to now think about how we wanted to go about this. And this was also the time that pay-as-you-throw was discussed at the same time.
I could interject. One thing we've noticed 10 years in, the initial life expectancy of the carts was about 10 years. That's what we were told. By all accounts, and you can judge it for yourself, you have one at your house and you use it, they're holding up tremendously well. We figure we'll be able to almost double that life expectancy. So they'll be bought and paid for this year, this coming fall, but we expect to get probably 10 more years of use. Now, Mike's crew does some repairs if a wheel blows or the lid gets blown off or whatever. What have you, we can fix that. But the carts themselves are very sturdy and should stand up and probably double the expected life.
But as an aside, they will not take hot ash from a fireplace.
It sounds like a story.
It's not personal experience, but I do know. So the automated system, now we start start to see a transition, and in that transition, what we have is each resident, each parcel, the card is assigned to the parcel, not the person. Each parcel has two cars to work. Both of them for a typical family, which is two adults and three others, are two 64-gallon containers. So we've got almost 130 gallons of total capacity on a weekly basis, which is still a very large amount. But we start trending towards pushing people, you know, helping them in a positive manner go to, you know, your trash can is full. What do you do now? There's recycling. You should be recycling. Let's try and work with it. We have some ordinance pieces that go along with it. We start having mandatory recycling ordinances. We start thinking about these things. We start seeing that, you know, recycling is starting to take off, and we'll see that in some numbers here in a little bit. So the program starts, you know, absolute success. You know, I mean, any program that we put out as a municipality, there will be some folks that aren't particularly thrilled with it or that it doesn't quite fit their needs. We've worked really hard to make sure that we've tried to deal with folks on a one-on-one basis as the program moves along. And I think all in all, it's been fairly well received and accepted. So I'm very pleased with it. And one of the things I'm really pleased about with this pay-as-you-throw program is that this particular system with the carts stays in place if the pay-as-you-throw is implemented. Obviously, it stays one way, the other stays in play. But this does not go away. This is augmented with a pay-as-you-throw system. So I think that's a neat thing.
I should also interject, there's one segment of our population that has never enjoyed the curbside program, and it's those folks that live on private ways that don't have frontage on a public road. There's a prohibition for spending public funds on private property.
Right.
And so there are, Mike has the statistics, there are a number of folks that live on private roads, and a number of the condominium complexes are also privately owned by the condominium association. So there are, from the outset and through today, there are segments, though they're fairly small, that have never enjoyed the service, yet they're helping pay for it because it's all underwritten by taxes. So I can tell you I've received complaints through the years from folks on that basis that I'm paying for it, but I don't get the service. And I don't know if you want to put a finer point on that, Mike.
Well, yeah, just to give you an idea of the magnitude. And overall, townwide, we did this based on the assessor's parcels. Residents, single-family residents that are eligible for curbside collection. There are 6,200 parcels that are, for all intents and purposes, single-family homes of some nature, be them a facing on a public road, being a condo unit dwelling, or on a private road. Now, of those 6,200, almost 5,500, 5,497 of the folks, of those units, 89%, have frontage on a public road. Okay, so 89%. Then there are another 517 units that are on private roads, so that's about 8%. Those folks currently with the program have one of two options. They can, because it's a private road and we can't pay to run a vehicle up there, there is a subscription service available that they can avail themselves of, or they can get the trash can to the intersecting public road and it'll be collected there. So the balance of the 6,200 folks or residents that are left remaining are about 177 units, or about 3% of the population, and those are condos. And those folks, for various reasons, mostly logistics, do not avail themselves of the program. And so that's kind of the breakdown there on that.
Councilor Hooper, can we ask questions as we go along? Do you mind?
Yeah. Yeah.
Of the 517, how many subscribe?
About 155.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. I got that number. That number was directly from Pine Tree Waste. I was curious
about
that myself, Councilor Dayline.
That 6,200, does that include rental apartments?
That includes, I believe, I would have to check with the assessor, but folks that five units and less are available, are eligible for for the curbside collection program. Beyond that, they're considered a commercial entity.
So they would still be paying for someone to haul off their trash?
Yes.
Typically, they're put into a large dumpster or a front load machine as opposed to the automated system.
So some of the condo units do that?
Some of the condo units do that, yes.
That's more the logistical challenges.
Is that counted against Scarborough?
No.
No.
So that's, again, like Toriano, whoever, that's what they're bringing into the waste stream?
Correct. Most of that trash is going to be brought in as residential trash. But there is, the thing to remember, though, is that we do have flow control in the town of Scarborough.
Mm-hmm.
So all waste that comes out of Scarborough by ordinance and by flow control ordinance has to go to Eco Maine. And that's an important thing to note because we want those tons and that revenue going to Eco Maine, not going elsewhere.
Well, that's why I'm asking if it's Toriano, for instance, just the ones I know haul most often that I'm familiar with, goes in and hauls for an apartment complex or a condo complex. That's why I'm asking, does that count for Scarborough's tonnage?
If it's commercial tonnage and they put it in as commercial, it doesn't.
Okay.
If they do parse it out as Scarborough municipal waste, then it.
But you don't know what they're doing right now.
It goes both ways, and as a practical matter, they know that waste is probably being put in under commercial.
Okay.
The good news is our collection provider services 89% of them, so we have great certainty that at least 89% or frankly more than that is definitely going to Eco Maine for sure. It's these other anomalies that are in question.
And even that piece, as an aside, has been a discussion at Eco Maine as far as tightening that loop, not just for Scarborough, but for all of the owner communities.
So to take that a step further, in a condo association for some of the larger ones, like you may have, I can't remember now how many are in the large, say 30 units in a condo association. That would be 30 people who would be doing pay per throw as opposed to having a commercial hauler do their garbage as they're doing now.
I don't see they would actually be able to do it either way.
I was gonna say, why would they change? I mean,
if it lowered their condo fees, for example. I mean, I'm just throwing that out.
You can't.
We still have the barrier of them residing on a public, a private way, and I think that's the barrier that we can't cross.
Definitely.
So they're going to still be. They're not been included in the 6,200 households.
I think we can continue with the arrangement they have in place.
The calculations work out off of the actual number of stops, not the eligible stops, not the total number of stops.
Okay.
So let's look to the numbers just to help make a finer point too.
So the report talks about some goals and some objectives potentially for this page and throw program specific to Scarborough. The number of 31.6% is about where we are at for recycling. We peaked at about 36% back in 2007-08, first full year of the program. And obviously trying to sustain a program is always the challenge. But this 31-32% has been very consistent. Running the numbers based on a proposal and some initial discussion with Waste Zero, provide a vendor, we can see about a 50% recycling rate and a 44% reduction in trash. Now that 44% reduction in trash is fairly universal. The EPA has some website documents that talk about that as well, as far as being a general rule of additional reduction when you go from any sort of system to a pay-as-you-throw system. Again, the piece about equity, we talked about it earlier. You become your own, your your own gatekeeper as far as what you're paying for your trash disposal purposes and that sort of thing. Right about now, using the EcoMaine numbers, we here in Scarborough are disposing of on a per-person basis a little over 500 pounds of trash on an annual basis. When you get to a pay-as-you-throw community, like Cumberland and some of those others, those folks are in the 236-pound range or so, Tom. The numbers are 579 pounds per year for a Scarborough resident, for a typical individual household person. With a 44% reduction, you get down to 324 pounds on an annual basis. So there's a big reduction there. And what that equates to for an average household is about 4.5 bags on a monthly basis. And so an annual cost on that, assuming the bags at a 60-40 split, would be about $108 on an annual basis.
$108 for the year, five bags.
That's
4.5 bags a month.
That's 60-40, meaning between large and small.
Yeah.
The proposal would have two different sizes that the residents would choose.
Okay.
They have different costs associated with them.
What are the costs of the bags?
Right now, it would be $175 and $2 is what we're using for our factors.
One, yeah, $125 and $2 have been used in this analysis.
Okay.
That's an issue that can be determined by this council.
So I just have one other question. I'm sorry. I'm making sure I have that right. So the average household would need 4.5 bags a month.
Yeah.
At the smaller bag or the larger bag?
That's
60-40. 60-40,
yeah. 60% large bags, 40%. So it'd be
Could be more.
Three bags, three large, two small.
And that's if they do 324 pounds
yeah.
a year versus
579.
If they were still producing the 579 out of a household, do you have an idea of how many bags a month that might be?
You've got, you're looking at four, instead of 4.5, you're looking at probably six.
But that exactly makes the point. The beauty
right.
is that if someone chooses to not change their behavior and is willing to pay for it, that's their business.
I just did some simple math because that's all I'm capable of, okay? One of the same, I'm looking at the fiscal year 16 number and I rounded it up to 540 and I divided it by 6,200 households and I came up with 87. Okay? Which, here's where I'm going with this.
Well,
did I do that right?
I think your math is flawed. Your methodology. I think you ought to use the bag revenue only in that calculation, not the cost of workers.
So don't even use. Well,
one's a cost savings, the other one's a revenue source. You don't want to combine them.
All right. Well, my point is that to me, it's like as an individual household, and I'm playing the devil's advocate here. As a household owner, I'm not saving enough in taxes by doing this if I'm going to have to go out and buy bags. That's just, and I may be comparing apples to oranges here. But if I'm looking at this as a taxpayer in the town of Scarborough, I'm not saving enough on this per household as to what it's going to cost for me to go out and buy bags.
I would agree with you.
So that's a tax shift. I think it's a tax shift.
Any ability to clarify that? I see the point you're getting.
See what I'm getting at? You're a math guy.
I haven't been able to process how the calculation works. That's why I...
Well, I think the concern comes out of, we're, in a nutshell, to sum that up, somebody like our household already recycles as
right.
much as we can and compost. So
right.
I don't expect my trash output to really change.
Mine either.
So I think that's what she's trying to understand is if you're already doing everything that you kind of
right.
can and you have to pay for the bags, where's
so
the
I had a constituent email me and point out, and he says, well, gosh, is there any way to measure or put the onus on people who don't recycle instead of those of us who do, because we already have a two recycling program. We have a recycling bin, and we have the regular trash. Why aren't we doing more to just do that instead of forcing everyone to go out and buy a bag?
I will make a statement. I think that, you know, it's human nature to say that we're doing all that we can in terms of it, everybody here, myself included. But I think that there is always more that can be done.
Well, that's true then.
So I think that, you know, the numbers that we talk about the reduction and that sort of thing, other communities that started out prior to this pay-as-you-throw system were in the 500-pound range as well. So,
right.
You know, we're doing a good job, 36%.
Yeah.
We are. That is good. But any documents that you see will talk about it is believable that a 50% recycling rate is achievable without an extraordinary amount of effort. And so
there's no question this is a tough sell for those that are already doing a very good job of
right.
recycling. But clearly there is so much there's not abuse, but there's so much that isn't getting done somewhere in this town.
And can I follow up, because my other concern with this is $2 a bag is a lot of money. And other communities aren't spending, unless it was Waste Zero, they aren't spending $2 a bag. Portland doesn't spend $2 a bag from what I understand. That's the stuff I saw online.
It's entirely a local choice.
Okay.
We needed to model this somehow. And those
right.
numbers are actually fairly commonplace. There may be lower ones. There are certainly higher
right.
ones.
Because you don't create any motivation if you charge a quarter.
No, I know that. Because when I'm on the island in the summer, I do this pay-per-throw in Portland.
Yep.
And then one other point to be made about that, because I see it happening on the island, it's gone to a different place, is that people try to get away with putting stuff into the recycling that shouldn't be going in recycling. And they have open recycling bins, so it's pretty obvious if someone's trying to get away with not putting something in a blue bag. We don't have that. We have the closed bins, so how are you going to prevent people from putting trash in the recycling?
The same way that we can see if people are using pay-as-you-throw bags, because there's cameras in the hoppers and the drivers can see what's going on before it gets dumped.
Have a no-no in that recycling bin.
Oh,
you just hop out and pull it out. I'm just here to.
Oh, okay.
But it was.
I mean, I'm just taking the questions that I had. Come on.
The contamination on the obviously has been always one of my concerns as well.
You're good.
But in conversation with Kevin Roach, general manager over at Eco Maine, it's not an appreciable difference between communities that are pay-as-you-throw and those that aren't in terms of contaminated
right.
loads. I mean, we bypass loads occasionally here as well.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
You know, in the summertime, we're going to have a big problem because there are so many rentals in this town. And to try to educate any of those people, it's never going to happen. It's never going to happen. We're going to have a ton of improperly disposed trash.
Was that a question or just a...
Just a statement.
Okay. Peter?
And maybe I'll direct this at you. Can you help me see if I'm looking at this correctly? Some of the comments that I've gotten is that somehow this is going to be a revenue center for the town. But as I understood it, what we're really talking about, whatever revenue this generates, we need to generate this revenue for the town. So it's either going to come through this type of process or we're going to have to get an equivalent amount through taxation. So what we're really talking about is not new revenue to the town. It's really talking about changing how we pay for the services. So
right.
it's not really a revenue service. So I think in this scenario, there'll be some people that will win and some people that won't.
Right.
But I just want to dispel, I think some people are thinking this is just new revenue to
right.
the town.
Right.
And what it really is just people in the town are either going to pay for the service this way
right.
or they're going to see more pressure on their real estate taxes. I think that's an important. Is that a true statement?
Yeah, I mean, our goal, I think, a valid goal of this from a financial point of view is to cover our MSW, that's our trash collection cost and disposal cost. I cannot imagine, unless you make your bags $5 a piece, that we'd ever generate enough money to exceed our solid waste expenses. So I think the goal ought to be limited to covering the costs associated with this effort. And the way we've modeled the goal would be to cover the costs associated with the solid waste management program we have that is historically and currently covered with taxed dollars.
Right. And I know that that's an issue for all municipalities with the waste management. I mean, it is a cost. Every time you throw something away, there's a cost to it.
It might be helpful to look at what the numbers mean, where we are currently with the current program, and what they might look like in the future. I think that helps round the conversation.
So,
I
really had a question.
Peter, did you get your?
Yeah.
Okay. I think it's actually Kate Carson, and then.
It's fine. I can wait till the end. I think you look at the numbers, and they look pretty, and this is, you know, overall. Sitting on this side of it, you know, we want to look at anything that can generate money for the town. But the feedback that I'm getting from people is there's absolutely no way I can take a hit somewhere else. So I understand what you're trying to say, but, I mean, now we're asking people to go buy trash bags. It's just, see, I feel like we're it's something constantly.
Couple of just comments. Most everybody that is putting out trash is bagged trash. Granted, they don't cost as much as these, but you know, there is. We're asking folks to do a different change, but it is bagged trash. And as Councilor Hayes said, it's either in this framework or a different framework, but it's going to be there someplace.
Yeah, so with respect to this particular slide, so if you note the start date is actually a 9-month start date.
Right.
So these numbers prorated for only 9 months, so the actual savings in a full year would be greater, but the savings plus the revenue?
The total column is annualized, 12 months.
So okay.
The parentheses is the proration to 9 months experience.
Oh, okay, sorry, I read that backwards. And then the second question I had is that it was really to Ms. Katarina's comment. The savings per household is really just the diverted tipping fees divided by the 6,200. And that comes out to $27.
Say that again.
If you take the 167 and divide it by the number of households, that's the savings on the taxes.
$27.
Which is 27. So you're forcing them to pay $108 to save $27.
Right.
So the net cost.
No, don't we get some of the revenue.
Right.
Yes. That comes
right. That's the cost. I'm talking about the impact of the taxpayer, not to the town.
There is a secondary benefit, though, Sean. There is, because that 480 is revenue that would otherwise be raised to property taxes. So we could do and should have done the calculation for an average valued home, what they're paying for solid waste collection under the current program. We can calculate that. Forgive me for not doing it for tonight. I will.
It's just a different form of taxation.
Right.
Yeah, I get that part of it.
And so it will go towards paying for the trash program.
Right.
But it
is
the 480 is just a flat out fee / tax.
Well, that's why I said take the 167.
The 167 is
taking out of one pocket versus the other.
That's the real savings in reduced cost in the program. And that would be reduced by the cost that we pay to run the program. These are $2 bags or $1.75, $2, whatever. It's in that ballpark. And you got to pay 22 to 29 cents. So it's about a 10% charge.
Right.
So you can take your 167 and reduce that by 10%.
How about a program to incentivize people to do recycling as opposed to saying, yeah, I got to go out and buy bags, you know, because we already have the double.
Can we actually just hold, he's not quite through his presentation, so some of that might, let's loop back to now.
Okay,
and,
yeah,
because
it might be cut
for
questions.
Yeah. Okay. So we threw some numbers out, inception of the new program, the automated program, versus prior to the automated program, our recycling rate was 19.5%. So what this graph shows us here is that since the inception of the automated program, with the additional recycling that we have done, we have taken, through diverted fees, taken out of the waste stream about $1.45 million worth of tipping fees. So
to the point of the current curbside program being a financial success, there's the proof.
That's it.
The other trend to notice is that we peaked in that first full year of 2007-08 at 36%, and we've kind of dipped
right.
down, and it appears that we've kind of plateaued off around 31%. And it's really that piece that we're looking to jump back up and exceed our past experience. And the next slide, I think, will show you what that will mean financially.
This slide right here, assuming if we had gone right out of the gate with a 45% recycling rate, again using that 19.5% as kind of that baseline piece, we would have seen a $3.5 million savings over the same inception period.
So that is the 1.4 million that Mike just talked about, which is the money we actually saved. And we're estimating that had we brought on a system like this at the same time in 2007, we would have saved an additional 1.9 for a total savings of 3.5.
And what was the previous slide? Again, I'm sorry, because I can't read it on...
1.457.
1.457. And that's
our documented savings.
That's strictly tipping fees. Savings in a very tipping fees.
It's a lot of what ifs. It's like the stock
market. Yeah, it is.
If I bought stocks 20 years ago, I would have been a rich man.
Yeah. Not necessarily. Fresh, though.
Well, it gives you an order of magnitude based on the data that we have as opposed to kind of broadcasting into the, forecasting into the future, and I think that's the value to it.
I mean, a legitimate question of this analysis, and one we've tested through interviews, and we've provided you verbatim comments to questions we've posed to Maine communities with this experience, is whether that 45% projection of recycling is reasonable. Can we actually attain that? And based on almost all the national data that the research we've looked at and validated by this kind of local knowledge, that is a reasonable target for purposes of evaluating.
So for the last 10 years, we would have actually 3.5 million over the last 10 years. So is it safe to say that projection-wise for the next 10 years, we'd actually have 5.5 million or 5.3 million because it's the 539 times 10? Oh, sorry, it's the 640 times 10, so 6.5 million?
Yeah, that's the...
I mean, it's kind of rudimentary.
We could be more exact than that, but that's the right magnitude.
Okay.
Can I ask...
One more question. Am I right that if the charge to run the program is to a third party, about 10% of the bag revenue? And I'm saying that because I think the bags are roughly $2 and the bag charge is 22 to 29 cents. So I'm just roughing it between 10 and 12, 12 and 14, 10 and 14.
About right.
That's about right?
Yep.
So that when you look at the bag revenue of... $480,000, so rounded $500,000. If it's 10%, then $50,000 comes off and goes over here to the provider of the service. And we're saving $167,000 in reduced costs there. So you really, to say, what is your real reduced cost? It's $167,000 less $50,000.
Right.
So it's about $100,000, $110,000
savings, roughly. Those are nets.
The charge is based on bag revenue. So it's roughly 10% of the bag.
Well, that 480 number in the first year for is
it's net of any expenses paid to a third party.
Yeah,
is net.
Those numbers are net of those costs.
So the revenue.
What it doesn't actually change the calculation much. What you do is add 10% to the 480, and then you have gross revenue.
Yes, sir.
Fair enough. Yes.
10%. I think I got the question answered.
Okay.
So the estimated cost per bag, which is one of the questions I've gotten from citizens,
right.
is approximately 20 cents a bag. The cost from waste zero is 20 cents. I thought I saw something in a press, it was like 29 cents, but that to me is still...
22 for the smaller ones.
I mean, it's going away zero, you mean?
Yes.
Okay.
So of the $2, if that's the price, or whatever the price is, 22 and 29 cents per bag is the cost that Waste Zero is getting.
Correct. And that's simply their proposal. We've not signed a contract.
Right.
We've not negotiated those numbers, but for purpose of the analysis...
Right.
No,
that's where we're starting.
You had to start somewhere.
And just to appreciate what we get for that, is it's not only just the bag, it's all the management associated with working with retailers and getting the distribution done and getting them on the shelves, collecting the fees, and then returning us on a monthly basis. So there's the financial management fees, kind of like some service fees.
Yeah.
There's a number of providers that we can go back and buy bags from, but we also see the value in having kind of this cover-to-cover benefit of managing the program and simply cashing the check on a monthly basis.
Right. Right.
Okay.
Hmm. Next slide.
That's just all values together.
Right.
What we do there
is
put them all in the same graph. This is the last one.
Yep.
So, what Tom and I have come up with, and what you see here is, you know, the assumptions and experience have been confirmed through the due diligence, the comments and the references that we've received from other communities. As Tom just mentioned, the value of that full-service vendor, that is not just, you know, that's not just about bags being shipped and then our own staff having to go out and deliver them, make sure that inventory is up to speed, chasing late payments and all that other sort of stuff. There's a value associated with that. That full-service vendor piece is very critical. And, you know, the reality of it is that pay-as-you-throw is the only way to effectively increase recycling and reduce costs. Human nature to want to do the right thing.
Mm-hmm.
When you incentivize, when you put a financial incentive behind that, it becomes even that much more compelling.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't make us bad people; it just makes us people.
Let me underscore that point. Let's say we do renewed education and outreach, which is something frankly we should be doing, regardless. I think it might be a push, but let's assume we get back to 36%. I think that's probably hard to do with just outreach and education. But that still leaves 9-10% of recycling on the table that can be achieved. And that's the real difference with a program like this.
Well, Ed?
I don't agree with you, Tom. I think I don't think anybody's ever done a really solid job of explaining to people what's recyclable and what should be trash. If we went out as a town and we had workshops or what have you, but did a good solid job of this is how you really recycle and give it a shot, I'm confident that you could reach easily 40% within a year. Because the people in this town are responsible. They understand what the problem is, and I think they would respond.
At the inception of the automated program, for the first three years of the program, we had a hired recycling coordinator that did outreach and education, and we maxed at 36.1%. She was getting into the schools. We were doing articles. She was doing outreach and that sort of thing. Eco Maine today still has on their staff an educator that gets into the school systems on an annual basis here in Scarborough and that sort of thing. And I think that's a testament to why our recycling is as high as it is. There's always room to do more, Councilor Blaze. I agree. But I think that to get back to 36 and get beyond 36 is a hard, is a tough pull.
Kate, I have so much respect for you. There are very few things that I've ever seen you present or talk about that I haven't 100% fully agreed with you. Maybe yesterday's traffic issue was, you know, that's another for another day. But this is a hard sell for me. Pers- of them because we didn't have, being not a counselor who was on the finance committee, I didn't have this information, so it was very difficult for me to get back to people. But the information that I did have, and because I know people and have relatives that live in cities and towns that do this, this is a really tough thing for me. And my personal opinion would be at this time would not be something that I could support this year. But, I mean, that's just being completely honest. And I totally see where it's going, and I see what's needed, and I understand that we're going to get hit somewhere. It's just this year, I think this is going to be a really tough thing to do to our residents.
Well, I think, you know, a couple of comments. You know, there is no doubt, and we talk about it in the full report, in the first paragraph. It is a very, these programs are easier to implement, are more accepted to implement when you're in a community that did not have a curbside collection program. When you have a feeling that when you have trash collection embedded in your taxes, and at a certain point, intellectually we all know trash collection is not free.
Right.
But if it's not coming out of your back pocket, it might as well be. And so that's a huge, huge shift. And it, along with it being a financial consideration, and I think that's why it's so important that you folks in the council make either make a decision of one way or another, embrace it, is that it's very much it's a policy decision as well.
Yeah.
And I don't discount that one bit, because you're absolutely correct.
Yeah, so I actually have a couple of, I forgot to ask questions as we went through them. You'd mentioned that we're coming to the end of, or in 2016 maybe, or 17, coming to the end of the lease agreement regarding the current.
2016.
Is it 16? Yeah.
Okay, this fall.
And then do we purchase them at the end?
We own them.
We own, oh, so we own
the final payment is this year.
Oh, okay. All right. I just wanted to know if there was an additional cost.
No.
The other question I had was, so I'm going to disagree with in minor areas with both of you. First is, it says up there that it's the only way to effectively reduce costs. But yet we look at other communities that have identified other ways. And I'll tell you, I'm actually very much in support of this. I will say also 100% of the people I've talked to, except for me, are totally against this. Totally against this. And so going back to the only way comment is, so I know South Portland's recycling committee, because my niece actually serves on that, looked at pay-as-you-throw and decided that this wasn't the most cost-effective. And in fact, I believe they implemented roadside compost program where they picked up food, basically, which I was then informed by Council Katarina that way back in the day when she was a young lady, very young girl.
It's up centuries ago.
Centuries ago. They actually used to do that, although in my time,
garbage man came.
They always had a barrel in the backyard and burned their own. But
we did.
Have we looked at, out of curiosity, has anybody in town looked at maybe an alternative to this being maybe the roadside composting?
Well, EcoMaine undertook a full feasibility study on taking on a composting program as well, and because of the fact that wet waste is less than 5% of the waste that we generate, the feasibility study basically said at this point in time it does not make sense to do it.
Okay.
The garbage to gardens and those sorts of smaller outfits. Because of the way they're set up with low overhead, with basically pickup trucks and dump trailers and that sort of thing, it works for them. But it's what you get out of the waste stream is every bit helps, but it's still
sure enough. Is South Portland a member? I don't remember because we both sat on EcoMaine. Is South Portland a member of EcoMaine?
Oh, yeah.
So their roadside composting program is purely done by their own community and not through EcoMaine?
Correct.
Okay.
Correct.
The piece that I would disagree with the manager on is around how the funds should be used, because one of the issues that I became aware of as part of being EcoMaine's board is that there is a future cost associated with landfill closure that as a owner community in EcoMaine that we're going to have to contribute some value to, which we can't really project right now. And this is a revenue stream that I think, personally, I believe, should be reserved, some portion of it should be reserved for that future long-term debt so that it doesn't go into the tax base because that way the people who are disposing waste today are paying for the future cost of closing that landfill, which is their responsibility. So I just disagree with where the money's going to go. So, you know, that's one of the, that has been one of my driving forces, because this community, like many others, do not look long-term out what their tax or liability responsibilities are. And we need to start saving for that to effectively manage the tax base, especially when we're talking about, you know, somewhere around everybody saying 2% is kind of the magic number this year. I just don't.
Mike, I think it would help us a little bit to understand our solid waste disposal, because historically, all towns, including ours, just put it in a dump, buried it. Now, EcoMaine takes it from us, and they burn the solid waste, produce electricity, sell the electricity as a revenue source, offsetting the cost of taking all that and doing it. It ends up then that what we're doing is we're not burying solid waste anymore, we're burying ash. And so from an environmental point of view, is that an appropriate disposal? Because how do environmentalists think in terms of this EcoMaine system as opposed to just putting it in the ground and covering it?
Well, I mean, there's a couple of schools of thought with waste energy facilities. There are some folks that think they're wonderful because they actually reduce the volume, thereby making the landfill smaller. There are also folks that are against waste energy because what it does is it creates an ash that if the incineration process is not done right, the resulting product is very potent. So, you know, the fact that we are consistently below mercury and mercury levels of release and that sort of thing is an indicator that we're a good environmental model to it. So, you know, I mean, I guess to your question, it's a split with waste energy and what people feel about it. I wish I could just say one way or the other, but I mean,
well, it looks like it's an advancement from just putting it in the ground.
Beyond that, most importantly, we're an owner community of EcoMaine. That decision was made 25, 30 years ago. As was mentioned, with that comes privilege, responsibilities and liabilities, and also that membership gives us consistent access and predictable access. So there's trade-offs in all of that. But whether it's the right thing to do or not, that decision was made 25 years ago, and we're part of that.
No, I mean, what I'm thinking is that what we did was we advanced beyond just burying the stuff to create an ash that was less of a problem from an environmental impact. And so, with, you know, the margin of improvement that you can get from now recycling more, you've narrowed the margin of improvement. That was what I was concerned we were. We're not getting as much of a bang for a buck as would be a community that just took all this solid waste and just buried it.
No, but I mean we're still going to see yet that like you said, that incremental reduction, which is still a critical piece.
Is there any other council?
I just want to clarify a couple of things. One is that there's really, and I'm just learning. So at the very first slide, it said reuse, recycle, and reduce. There's actually additional components to the theory around solid waste management, and one of that is that there's also a burn component that, you know, EcoMaine creates electricity and sells it onto the market, which helps fund the solid waste management program as far as reducing costs, just as the recycling is resold on the market as well.
Okay.
If I'm correct, don't they currently, when demand or when solid waste is down, they go in and they redig up all the stuff that just got buried, burn it, and put it through the new recycling process, and then rebury the ash. Is that correct?
Correct.
That's right.
Correct.
So there is a process in which they are reclaiming the land as far as being able to take the stuff out, because you'll be surprised, stuff that was buried 20 years ago,
right,
that you could still tell it's a Lay's jet paper or plastic bag. It's pretty
incredible. It's a fuel source to keep the system working at an efficient level.
But the area that's being in 8 years, the area of that landfill on Running Hill Road is actually, it's maximized. You can't use it anymore because the state says that it's completely full and you can't rebuild. burn or...
And then we have land for other cells that we will, that
right.
we will open up at that point in time. Yeah.
So they're constantly looking at how to become efficient as well, EcoMaine.
I just want to make sure I have the consensus that it's okay to run a little over for our council meeting. Okay. Can I, before we continue some dialogue, let me just jump for a moment to the audience to see if there's any questions about... Well, do we need a microphone or just...
I can speak loudly enough, you can hear me.
I'm not sure if those at home can, that's the problem.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I didn't realize it would be broadcast.
It is.
No. So if I could, be a thing and I just ask you
don't
to...
Don't make up first.
I just wanted to mention a couple of numbers. It's been a lot of numbers here. I think I heard that the average household is 500 pounds a year.
What was that? 5.75?
Well, bear with me for a second. Let's round it to 500. I think the numbers is that's a quarter of a ton.
For person, right?
For person.
So at $70 a ton, that's $17 per household per year.
Per person.
Per person.
Okay, but yeah. Okay, now let's talk about equity then. I only have two people in my household, but I pay the same as everybody else. I want to talk about equity. I'd like you to reduce my taxes by the amount that I contribute to the school system, which is about 47% of my taxes, for which I get nothing. Never have. I've never had a kid in school here. I moved here when I was in my 60s. So you want to talk about equity. That's not equity.
Oh, you reminded me, I'm sorry. Could we have your name?
My name's William Foley.
And thank you. Any other questions?
And we do have general public comment after as well, so if you want to make a comment.
My name is Susan Hannah. And I did go on the Waste Zero website today, and they have a program that's called More in Return. It's an option that they offer to their client town, where... you still buy bags, but the revenue from the bag comes back, it gets tallied up, and at the end of the year, they do all the accounting and figure out how much they made, and they rebate it to the all the households. And they give it to you on a little credit card, like a debit card, so that if the goal is really to reduce the amount of trash that we are putting out there, then this is still, you know, you still have to go out and buy a bag for $2. But let's say we had our year September to September, and it ends, and then they tally up how much they make, and we still save $100 for the reduced tipping. It doesn't make a tax increase on the residents, because we are all in favor of transparency these days, that... so you won't get the extra $400,000, but, you know, and other towns also, they'll give two bags, you get, you know, a bag a week. And if you have more than that, then you have to buy this, five bags.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Any other questions? Okay. So, I had a friendly, quiet reminder from Tody, we do have something coming. So, I did just want to ask... certainly we can't make any action. This is a workshop. But I would hope that we could maybe have a consensus as far as a feeling of perhaps if there's interest to maybe postpone coming into pay this role to have some time to explore a few other options. Certainly, I personally... question the $2 a bag. You know, I think that's a little much. As was mentioned, I know there's some communities that give you, you know, a bag, and then if you're over that, you know, maybe exploring some other options. And that's my own personal thought on it. I feel it's a little quick to move through to. I'd like to see a timetable to work people coming into it as far as, you know, more education about if we're going to go to this program, this is the start date, that, you know, so I think there's a few things that would need to be, maybe personally, I feel there's a few things
that need to be worked. So my question is if there's a consensus to postpone this program to a future date, maybe not to go away, but to let finance work it some more, because there is a finance implication for that,
right,
that staff and finance committee will need to work with, rather than a last-minute swing at a second reading on the council floor, because it is in this budget. So, again, it's not binding. Certainly, you know, this is a workshop, but is there was some consensus to want to maybe postpone this program for now.
Mm-hmm.
So if I'm looking, I'm just kind of, you know, if I can just kind of get a gray, raise a hand, if I see one, two.
So what do you...
I'm agreeing to postponing this for
the implementation of
finance to take a better look at this.
Yeah.
There's no way I'm in any condition to see this go anywhere at this point.
Yeah, and I agree. I'm in the same boat. I think it needs some more examination. I don't think right now we're ready to do this as a town.
I mean, I think it's pretty clear it lacks an endorsement from us at this point. We have way too many doubts. I think I like the idea of it going back to Sean's committee and being studied further. We've got still April and May, and you know, before we started July 1 budget. I'd certainly like the idea of, I'm not very well educated on recycling, and yet I'm interested. So I'd like the idea that the schools, we got 3,000 kids who would be great advocates for it. And so there's a lot of things about this that I really do like.
Right.
The composting concept, again, I think there's some real value in all of that. And this lady just spoke on different ways, more in return programs,
right,
and ways that I think we need some more study, and that we might be able to come up with a way that we can improve things on all these different factors that we all agree are good principles, but we need to work at it a little bit more to get into our comfort zone.
So do we have a committee to explore what is an alternative? I don't believe it is an appropriate task for the finance committee. We know what the financial implications are.
Yes.
I already know where I'm going to vote, and it's to remove it. I think we should just stand up and say either yes or no, period. And I think that we should assign it to the right committee to do the exploration. I don't know if it's the energy committee, if they also take care of recycling. I don't know if there's
a working group
or something to really look at that, so that we also receive the citizen input at that particular level about where do we go. You can't really analyze the finances here any more than what
the committee's got a full plate from now till June.
Right.
So let me cut everybody off short, because we do have to get to our meeting. Tom and I will work on for our next council meeting to have something in front of us for a resolution to form an ad hoc committee to study the program.
Good.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.